Hello everyone, this is Suvanshu here. In today's video, I'll be talking about some basics of cardiology and about the heart murmurs. So to start with the basics of cardiology, we should know how the blood travels in our body. So let's assume that the blood comes in our right atrium through superior vena cava and inferior vena cava, and keeping in mind that this is deoxygenated blood. Then through the tricuspid valve, it travels into the right ventricle. Then through the pulmonary valve, it goes into the pulmonary artery, and then into the pulmonary artery, it goes and carries deoxygenated blood to the pulmonary circulation. From there, it comes from the pulmonary vein into the left atrium. After coming in the left atrium, this is oxygenated blood. It goes from the mitral valve into the left ventricle and then through the aortic valve, through the aorta, to the whole body, where it is deoxygenated again, and it again comes back to the superior vena cava and inferior vena cava, and the cycle keeps on continuing. So it is a very complex procedure. But to sum it up, it's very simple that the blood travels from right atrium to right ventricle to again it comes back to left atrium and then to left ventricle and then to the whole body. And to keep all this going, our heart keeps on contracting and relaxing at different paces. Atria relax and contract at a different pace and ventricle relax and contract at a different pace. And whenever we use the term diastole or systole, we are always referring to the ventricles. That means whenever I say systole, that means the ventricles are contracting at this state. No matter whatever the condition is of atrium, I don't care about that. It only matters that the ventricles are contracting right now, then it is called systole. And if the ventricles are relaxing, it is called diastole. Now, to understand the basics of murmur, we should know about at least two physiological heart sounds, which are S1 and S2. There are also other heart sounds, S3, which can be physiological as well as pathological, and S4, which is always pathological. But here I will be only talking about couple of lines about S1 and S2. S1 occurs due to closure of AV walls. AV walls means atrioventricular walls. That means the walls which prevents or which allows the blood going from atrium to ventricles. That is tricuspid valve and mitral valve. Tricuspid valve is on the right side and mitral valve is on the left side. And talking about S2, that is heart sound 2, which occurs due to closure of semilunar valves. Semilunar valves are the valves which prevents the blood or allows the blood to go from right ventricle to pulmonary circulation or left ventricle to aortic circulation. That means semilunar valves are pulmonary valve and aortic valve. So now let's talk about murmurs. Murmur are abnormal sounds heard during the cardiac cycle. These are heard due to two causes. Number one cause can be due to abnormally increased pressure gradient in a normal direction of flow. Like normal direction of flow is right atrium to right ventricle. And normal pressure gradient, if it exceeds, then it will cause a murmur. Here is the first cause, that the pressure gradient is abnormal but the direction of flow is normal. Second cause is that the direction of flow is also abnormal. I'll give you some examples here. For example, when I talk about mitral stenosis, means that the left atrium blood is not able to come back into the left ventricle during diastole. During diastole, normally the blood should come from left atrium to left ventricle. But here, in case of mitral stenosis, the blood is not able to come. Hence, there is abnormal pressure gradient buildup in the left atrium and low pressure in the left ventricle, which leads to decrease in the pressure gradient and the murmur is heard. I'll explain the mechanism of murmurs later, but just for a brief, in cases of stenosis, there is increased in the pressure gradient, and in cases of regurgitation, there is abnormal direction of flow. For example, in cases of mitral regurgitation, normally during contraction or during systole, the blood goes from left ventricular to aorta. But here, in cases of mitral regurgitation, what happens is that this valve does not close properly. And if this valve does not close properly, that when this contracts, the pressure in the LV increases and the blood goes into the aorta as well as through the mitral valve into the left atrium, which leads to the abnormal direction of flow. That is, it goes from left ventricular to left atrium, which results in murmur. So the regurgitant lesions are mostly due to abnormal direction of flow, and in cases of stenotic lesions, this is due to increased pressure gradient. So to understand the murmurs, we should know whether it is coming in the systolic period or whether it is coming in the diastolic period or it is coming throughout. So we will be categorizing it into three parts. First would be systolic murmur, second would be diastolic murmur, and third would be a continuous murmur. So to talk about systolic murmur, we should know the basics of systole. What happens in a systole is that first the ventricle starts to contract, and as soon as the ventricle starts to contract, it is called as a systole. Now, initially, the pressure in the ventricle is not very high, and all the valves are closed. That is, mitral valve, aortic valves. I am considering left ventricle here. Similar happens in right ventricle. So, initially, systole, the mitral valve and aortic valve both are closed. Hence, there is a contraction, but the volume does not change. It is known as isovolumetric contraction. After some time, when there is a pressure build up in the left ventricle due to contraction, then what happens is, because of the pressure, the aortic valve opens, and as soon as the aortic valve opens, the blood goes from the left ventricle into the aorta, which is the normal physiological cycle, that after some time of the systole, the semilunar valves will open and the blood will go into the aorta and it will circulate in the body. But in some cases, if there is some obstruction or some lesion, anything in this area, that is aortic valve area, then it can cause a systolic murmur. Systolic murmur, which is occurring only after the opening of semilunar valves, is called as mid-systolic murmur or ejection systolic murmur or crescendo-decrescendo murmur. It occurs after the semilunar valves open, the blood flows, and then when the blood keeps on flowing, the pressure gradient keeps on decreasing as the blood keeps on flowing, then it again comes down in a decrescending fashion. Hence the name crescendo-decrescendo. Now to understand the examples of this condition, I already gave you one example that in cases of aortic stenosis, what will happen is that the blood will not be able to go properly from left ventricle to the aorta, which will lead to the murmur, that is, which will lead to abnormal pressure gradient in normal direction of flow. This is normal direction, but the pressure gradient is abnormal because here it is a stenosis and blood cannot flow. In similar cases, in aortic stenosis, in pulmonary stenosis, in aortic aneurysm, when there is dilatation of the aorta, in pulmonary aneurysm, when there is dilatation of the pulmonary circulation, and in all cases of high cardiac output states, what will happen is that the more blood has to go in a normal direction. And when more blood has to go, that means cardiac output is high, more blood has to go, which will again lead to stenosis. It is not an actual anatomical stenosis, but it is a functional stenosis. It's like a tunnel which can take a limited amount of a substance, but here the substance is more, so there is some abnormal sound created due to extra blood which is flowing in high cardiac output states. And in high cardiac output states, it is also called as functional stenosis. And these two are anatomical stenosis. So, high cardiac output states have certain examples which I'll be talking about in detail in other video, but here I'll just enumerate some of the examples. You can divide them into two causes, cardiovascular causes and non-cardiovascular causes. Cardiovascular causes will include aortic regurgitation. What happens in aortic regurgitation is that in the first cycle, when the blood goes from left ventricular to the aorta, the blood goes like this, and then when the ventricles dilate, normally this valve should close. But here in this case, aortic regurgitation, this valve does not close and the blood comes back into the left ventricle, which leads to more blood in the left ventricle for the next cycle. That means for the next cycle, it will be a high cardiac output state. Similar example is a mitral regurgitation case. Similar example is a patent ductus arteriosus. Non-cardiovascular causes are pregnancy, thyrotoxicosis, beriberi, Paget's disease. And in cases of also AV fistula, you can see high cardiac output states. I will be talking about the mechanism in another separate video because it will be very hard to cover this topic in this video. Now, this was about the first murmur, which you are hearing only after some time of the systolic started, and it ends as soon as you hear the S2. Now, there can be another type of systolic murmur in which as soon as you hear the S1, the murmur starts. To know that what's the importance and significance is that because semilunar valves open afterwards, so and the murmur starts just after the S1, that means it has no relation with semilunar valves. It is also known as pansystolic murmur and it is not related to semilunar valves. And it occurs in cases of ventricular septal defect. What happens is when you systole the left ventricle and there is a septal defect in here, the blood will go from left ventricular to right ventricle, which is an abnormal direction of flow, which will lead to a murmur. So it is a case of pansystolic murmur because it is not related to semilunar valve. It occurs in a case of systole when the left ventricle contracts, the pressure increases, the blood goes from the septum into the right ventricle. Another example is chronic MR and in chronic TR. In chronic MR and in chronic TR, what happens is when the blood normally in systole, this valve should be closed because the blood has to go only into the aorta or only into the pulmonary circulation. But in cases of chronic MR or chronic TR, what happens is this valve is also open during this valve is also open during the contraction or during the systole, which means that when this contracts, the blood also goes into the mitral, into the left atrium or into the right atrium, which again leads to abnormal direction of the blood flow, and then it again leads to a murmur. Hence, in a case of chronic MR or chronic TR, the pressure gradient will always be maintained due to, as it is a chronic case, the left atrium is dilated and hence the pressure gradient is maintained. Hence, it is always pan-systolic. You will understand this concept a little bit later when I will talk about early systolic, which is the next topic. In early systolic, what happens is acute MR or acute TR, what happens is when the blood starts to move initially, left ventricular pressure is very much high because it is contracting, and left atrium pressure is low because it does not have any blood. And as soon as the systole continues, the left ventricular pressure keeps on decreasing because the blood keeps on going out into the aorta as well as into the left atrium. But the left atrium pressure keeps on increasing because it receives blood. So what happens is the pressure gradient, that is pressure of left ventricular minus pressure of left atrium, it keeps on decreasing as this keeps on decreasing and this keeps on increasing. So it only occurs up to the early systole. That means it will close before even mid systole. It is known as early systolic murmur, and it occurs in cases of acute MR and acute TR. It stops because the pressure gradient becomes zero before mid systole, because LA is not dilated here to maintain the blood which it receives. In cases of chronic TR, what happens is the blood which goes into the right atrium or into the left ventricle, left atrium, the atrium is already dilated. So the more blood does not cause the increase in the pressure. Here, the more blood will cause increase in the pressure, which will lead to the decreased pressure gradient, which will again lead to the disappearance of murmur. Hence, it is a case of early systolic murmur. In cases of late systolic murmur, there is only one example that you have to learn, and it occurs after mid-systole and ends just at S2, and the example is mitral valve prolapse. Now I will be talking about diastolic murmurs and continuous murmurs.